الحمد لله، نحمده سبحانه ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهدي الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه، قد بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في سبيل دينه حتى أتاه اليقين. فاللهم اجزه عنا وعن والدينا وعن الإسلام والمسلمين خير ما جزيت به نبيا عن قومه ورسولا عن أمته. اللهم أحينا على سنته، وأمتنا على ملته، واحشرنا تحت لوائه، وأوردنا حوضه، واسقنا من يده الشريفة شربة هنيئة لا نظمأ بعدها أبدا. اللهم أمين. We are going to continue to address the youth regarding their mission. I'm talking about our children who have reached the age of puberty and responsibility, who are supposed to have started praying on regular basis, learning the Quran, learning the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I know that many of them, the vast majority of them, are not here. We have few of them, but I am talking to them on the hope that at least you will point them to this khutbah on YouTube after the Jum'ah, inshallah. So I hope that this message will find resonance with their hearts, minds, and souls. Our youth, you need to know what is your mission in life. And your mission, like ours, is the same. We are all required to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا. Worship Allah and associate none with Him. None. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. And be good, kind, and respectful to your parents. وَذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ وَالْجَارِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْجَارِ الْجُنُبِ وَالصَّاحِبِ بِالْجَنْبِ وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ وَمَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُحِبُّ مَنْ كَانَ خَوَّانًا كَفُورًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructs all of us as Muslims to be in the worship of Allah 24/7. And the meaning of worship in Islam, as we all know, is not limited to prayer and fasting. The meaning of worship is to submit all your matters, all your energy, all your resources, all the blessings that Allah has given you, to submit all of this to Allah and to check with the book of Allah on every turn and every corner. Wherever you are, the Quran should be in front of your eyes. Wherever you are, Allah should be ahead of you. Ya Bunayya, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to his cousin Ibn Abbas, Ya Bunayya, ihfazi Allah yahfazk. O my son, keep Allah so that Allah would keep you. Ya Bunayya, ihfazi Allah tajidhu tijahak. Keep Allah so that you will find Him always looking after you and waiting for you wherever you are heading. So those are not ideas. Those are not philosophy principles. Those are guidelines from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, coming to him from Allah, and he is only communicating the message. Innama alayka al-balagh. The Prophet's mission is to communicate the message. Our mission as Muslims is to follow suit of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was mercy to the world, we should be mercy to the world. The ayah I just cited from Surah An-Nisa tells us, all Muslims, young and old, to worship Allah and associate none with Him, because He has no equals, He has no partners, He has no associates, He has no consultants, because He needs none. He stands alone as the God of the universe. He has created everything alone. He didn't need help from any source. As such, he is the only one who ought to be worshipped without association of any partners or erecting any equals to him. فَاعْبُدُوا اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. And you must be good to your parents. Even if your parents are not Muslims, you must be good to your parents still. The only time when you disobey your parents, according to the guidance of the Quran, is if they push you to turn against Allah. But so long as they do not, they are your parents and they deserve your utmost respect and your utmost support. وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا وَذِي الْقُرْبَى وَالْيَتَامَى وَالْمَسَاكِينَ. Your relatives, your kin, the poor and the destitute, all of those are classes of people that the ayah is talking about that we must be good to as if we are good, equally the same to our parents. Why? Because they are part of our human family. And you will read the ayah till the end. وَالْجَارِ ذِي الْقُرْبَى, the neighbor who happens to be a relative. وَالْجَارِ الْجُنُبْ, and the neighbor in proximity who lives next door, up to 7 neighbors on all sides. Then وَالْجَارِ بِالْجَنْبْ وَالصَّاحِبِ بِالْجَنْبْ. So you have all categories of people that you come across included in the ayah. وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ, the wayfarer, the traveler, the stranded, the one who doesn't know where to go, he doesn't know where he will spend his night, where to go take his food. Those people are ours to honor and to host and to respect. So if you notice, all these categories in the ayah are not attached to them being Muslims or non-Muslims. It's an amazing principle of inclusion, that my goodness is not limited to my family. My goodness is not limited to my neighbors. My goodness is not limited to a person being Muslim or non-Muslim, so long as this non-Muslim and those Muslims are not turning against me because of my faith. They are all brothers and sisters at one level or another. All humans are told we are one family. Unless we reach with love and compassion to our neighbors and to the rest of society, they will always turn to us with animosity, misunderstandings, Islamophobia, attacking Islam and Muslims. Many of the non-Muslims who embraced Islam at one time or another in their life, most of them say, I didn't read a book before I embraced Islam. I met a Muslim. And alhamdulillah, by and large, Muslims are generous. Muslims, by and large, they are honest. Muslims, by and large, they are friendly. And they are with the tendency and the heart to do what is good. We need you, our youth, to make those examples alive and helpful to our da'wah, so that if you win your neighbors, if you win your classmates, if you win your workmates, then whom are you losing? The only way that we survive as Muslims in this country is by expanding the circle of Islam and Muslims. And this comes through our preaching and teaching and education. To educate your friend, you have to learn. To talk about Islam, you have to learn. You have to read what Islam is. The first ayah that came down in the Quran is read. Read. Most of us, unfortunately, we talk and then think about what we say, then we start reading. It should be the other way around. Do not talk about something you don't understand. وَلَا تَقْفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ. When you want something, learn it from its sources. We have the Quran, we have the Sunnah, and we have other sources Let us learn our deen. Let us practice our deen. Let us teach our deen to our neighbors with love and compassion. This is how you win the world over. You are not gonna invade the world and win them by the sword. Muslims never did that. Muslims have always traded love for love, compassion for compassion, goodness for goodness, righteousness for righteousness. And they increased above that by meeting something bad with something good. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, اِدْفَعْ بِالَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. The best response to Islamophobia is a statement of respect, a statement of love, a statement of compassion, and an open-minded discussion. Islamophobia, you are not going to defeat it by the force of anything except the force of your faith and the power of your manners, the power of your ethics, the power of your principles, and the power of your example. So we need to look at those issues. How far have we gone? How much distance do we need to go before we are all, every one of us, an effective Muslim da'iya, somebody who can carry the message of Islam in truth, in love, and in justice? We are not saying that we should cow down to anybody. We are not asking anybody to bow to anyone other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are saying stand with dignity, but stand on the foundation of knowledge, mercy, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do. So the first thing that I want to direct to you, our youth and our children, boys and girls, is to ask yourself, do you know your mission in this life? Do you know why Allah created you and sent you and the rest of the world a prophet and a message? The prophet is Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Before him came so many other prophets. They are all exemplary models for humanity. Much of the people we live around, and they live around us, they do not know who are the prophets, why did Allah send them, what is the final message, what makes the Quran the most authentic book of revelation ever sent to mankind. On what basis do you say that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last prophet? And mind you, as Allah has told us in the Quran, الْيَوْمَ أَكْمَلْتُ لَكُمْ دِينَكُمْ وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينَ, that our deen is fully complete and fully perfected to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's what the ayah is saying. So Islam, as far as the resources, the Quran and the Sunnah, it is finished. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not leave it open for us. He only entrusted us to learn it, practice it, and teach it. Three missions: learn it, practice it, and teach it. That's how we reach with the Quran to others around us. So if we learn it but don't practice it, there's no role model. And if we learn it and practice it but do not teach others, there is still a lot of ignorance around us, and ignorance creates animosity. الْإِنسَانُ عَدُوْ مَا يَجْهَلْ. Man takes for enemy things that he doesn't know about. And there is a lot of misinformation and disinformation about Islam and Muslims. Your neighbors may think that you are here to sabotage his peace and his country. You need to prove it to them that you are here to spread peace, justice, mercy, compassion, and you are willing to be the first one to lead in that direction. Your neighbor thinks that you are here to undermine their way of life. Their way of life may not be exactly what Islam says, but there are a lot of general principles with which we Muslims agree with our Christian neighbors, Jewish neighbors. We agree, all of us, that Allah is one. We agree that our purpose in life is to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They might have turned into materialism because of the education they got. they might have turned to secularism, which is a response to the overarching, overburdening, overbearing control of the church, of public life, to the point of suffocation. People revolted against religions in general because of the experience they had with the church in Europe. Let us not promote a form of Islam that looks like the form of the church, that requires somebody to be speaking in the name of God and his word is as good as God's word. We don't have papacy in Islam. We don't have priesthood in Islam. We have open books that the enemy and the believer, they can read. Those who believe, those who don't, they can read the Quran. The Quran is available. It's an open book. You shouldn't be shy to present it to anyone, but pick a good translation. Be cognizant that there are forged translations that aim at sending the wrong message about the Quran and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So whenever anybody tries to undermine your faith by spreading doubts and suspicions about your deen, saying, who tells you that the sunnah is really part of the message? Who tells you? There are lots of ahadith that are da'if and mawdu' and all of that, as if they have learned this on their own. It's amazing. All of those who are attacking Islam, as far as the sunnah is concerned, they are relying on the sunnah to attack the sunnah. It's just an amazing approach. They tell you Abu Huraira and other Sahaba, they were not this, they were not that. All of these are rumors, because our early scholars have sifted through this 100,000 times for us to receive and learn what book of hadith is most authentic and what comes next. We have Al-Bukhari, the top, we have Muslim, second, and we have other books that come after that that has some hadith that are not up to the standard of Bukhari. The standard of Bukhari for inclusion is more stringent and higher than the standard of Imam Muslim. Imam Muslim's standard is better than in stringence. It's much more stringent and much more tight than Imam Ahmad and Nasa'i and others. So we learn this from our scholars. You don't need somebody to attack these scholars and their collections. Does this mean that there is not a hadith that could be misunderstood? Of course. Of course, some people misunderstand the Quran itself. With all the precautions Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken to keep it pure, until now, when the text is clear, somebody may come and say, that's not what it means, that's what it means, because we have our whims and desires. So there will never be time when all humanity agree to any one thing. Humanity, as we know, they disagree even if they know what Allah is saying, whether it is his right or not. That's why we have atheists, we have agnostics, we have people who worship idols and cows and trees and other things. Why? Because we are created different. Our ability to understand is not the same. Our ability and desires to understand are not the same. So we'll continue to have differences. وَلَوْ شَاءَ رَبُّكَ لَجَعَلَ النَّاسَ أُمَّةً وَاحِدَةً وَلَا يَزَالُونَ مُخْتَلِفِينَ إِلَّا مَنْ رَحِمَ رَبُّكَ. اللهم ارحمنا. So Allah is telling us that if Allah had willed it, all humanity would have been united, which means on faith. They would have been one ummah, one community, one society, one direction. But because of who they are, humans, with desires, faculties and capabilities that are not the same, they end up either liking something or not liking something. And Allah is telling us, if he had willed it, he would have made the whole of humanity as one ummah, but still they will have differences. Except for those whom he has bestowed his mercy upon them. إِلَّا مَنْ رَحِمَ رَبُّكَ وَلِذَٰلِكَ خَلَقَهُمْ, which means خَلَقَهُمْ لِيَرْحَمَهُمْ. Allah created us to bestow His mercy upon us, to show us His mercy. He created the whole universe for us before He had created us. It is like, no tashbih, but it is like, just for illustration, you are expecting a baby. Before the baby is born, a month or two, the crib is ready. The sleeping quarter is ready. All other needs of the baby are at home. The hospital arrangement is made. You know the doctor, you know where is he going to be delivered, and you prepare everything for the baby, provided you have the means. Allah had all the means to create the heavens and the earth and to set them up to serve our existence. وَسَخَّرَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا مِنْ. We need to communicate this message to every human being we get in touch with. That is the da'wah of Islam. The da'wah starts with our knowledge, our practice, then our teaching for others who are interested to learn. There is no pushing or shoving or coercion. Let there be no coercion in Islam. So we have to do our part by giving the time for our deen to learn it. I want to see the youth back in the masjid, like the children of the Sahaba. You say they cannot come on Friday. Fine. Let them pray Friday in their school. But you help them do that. But other than Friday, why aren't they here in the classes? Why aren't they here praying? Brothers, one generation, this mosque will not have any one of us here. Who's next? Who's coming after us? If Trump gets his way and he bans Muslims from coming, there will be no immigration. I hope this never happens, but that's his plan. So if there is no immigration, what happens to the masajid? Will our children witness a time when mosques will turn back into churches or will be used for something else or will be turned like youth clubs? We need to guarantee and secure that our children not only are familiar with the mosque, the role of the mosque, and their role in the mosque, and their role in building and continuing the work of the community, but we also want them to love it. This is the house of Allah. This is the house that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فِي بُيُوتٍ أَذِنَ اللَّهُ أَن تُرْفَعَ وَيُذْكَرْ فِيهَا اسْمُهُ وَيُذْكَرْ فِيهَا اسْمُهُ يسبح له فيها بالغدو والأصال رجال لا تلهيهم تجارة ولا بيع عن ذكر الله. Brothers, we need our children to connect with the masjid. Otherwise, how would they carry the mission? How would they carry the message of Islam? How would they themselves understand Islam? But let's ask the other question. Who's going to teach their children when their own parents are gone? Who's going to teach the children that comes next? I believe we must plan for this. This masjid and all and every mosque in America should focus on the youth presence, the youth attendance. Some of us are focusing on youth leadership without youth teaching. You don't want to teach them, but you want them to lead because we are lazy. Or we give up on ourselves. But Umar ibn al-Khattab used to say, تَفَقَّهُ قَبْلَ أَن تُسَوَّدُ. Learn before you lead. Don't accept a position of leadership because that inflation of personality is deceptive. People want to give you a false sense of accomplishment by setting you up as a leader without giving you the tools to lead. And leadership is not just about being a scout leader or anything like this. Leaders in Islam are primarily knowledgeable people in the community. Then there are areas of leaderships that are different than just the leadership in knowledge. But they all require knowledge. There is no leadership without knowledge. How do you attract people to follow If you are not a model in your knowledge, a model in your life, and in your practice. So we all need to learn. We all need to attend classes. We all need to bring our children to the masjid. Of course, on Friday prayer, many of us, if not all of us, are coming from work and maybe going back to work right there after we finish. But don't forget, there are 5 prayers a day that you can bring your children to, not only Friday. So please make sure that, as we mentioned last time, the first thing to empower our children with is faith and knowledge. Faith and knowledge. So how do we develop their faith based on no knowledge? They need to know. Most of us are eager to see their children praying, but we are not as eager to teach them how to pray and what to benefit from the prayer, or why should we keep up with the prayer. Those are basic fundamental issues. So we need to focus on what lasts for our children so that they learn not only to practice, but they learn how to raise their own children as Muslims. The challenges that face our children, specifically our youth, are tremendous. And many of us do not even talk to them. And when we do, it is only when there is a problem. We don't talk to our kids unless they do something wrong. We need to catch them doing something right and talk to them and encourage them and support them. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam tells us, خَيْرُكُمْ مَنْ تَعَلَّمَ الْقُرْآنَ وَعَلَّمَ. You want to be the best in the community? Learn Quran and teach it. You become our best, because who could do away with Quran if you are a Muslim? Could we live without the Quran? Could we practice our deen without the Quran? So we need people who take leadership role in learning and teaching Islam, not only to our children, but to each other. Until today, we do not have someone to stand up and teach Arabic for non-Arabic speakers. So we have to do everything in English to accommodate and reach out to those who have not learned Arabic. Why don't we get 10, 15 volunteers to teach Arabic for each other and learn each other's language? If you don't know enough English, we have ESL classes. If you don't know computer skills, we have computer labs to teach you or your wife or your children. So please take an active role in building yourself. In building yourself, you're advancing the cause of the community and the cause of Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the conviction and the energy to learn our deen, to practice our deen, and to teach it to those who don't know it. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وبعد. Brothers and sisters, young and old, please remember that on the day of judgment, we are all going to stand questioning. That much I hope we all know and believe. What are we going to be asked about? There are 4 issues. لا تزول قدم عبد يوم القيامة حتى يسأل عن 4. Nobody will move his foot on the day of judgment, will not be able to take a step before he answers 4 questions, 4 areas. عمره ماذا فيما أفناه. What did you use your life to do? What did you dedicate your life for? وشبابه فيما أبلاه. What cause or causes have you served as a young man? What did you struggle in the most productive time in your life when you were a youth and you had all the discretionary time, discretionary money, discretionary resources? What did you do with this as a young man? Powerful, strong, and your future is ahead of you. What did you do? Third, عن علمه ماذا عمل فيه. Your knowledge, what did you do with it? Did you benefit from your knowledge? Did you apply your knowledge? Or did you ignore the knowledge you already have? Imam Ali used to say, من عمل بما علم أورثه الله علم ما لم يعلم. Let me explain. He's saying, if you practice what you know, Allah will help you when you face something about which you don't know what to do. When you face an issue, but you practice all you know, Allah will help you with that which you do not know. Very important. علمه ماذا عمل فيه. His knowledge, what did he do with it? And the fourth is a double question issue. وماله مما اكتسبه وفيما أنفقه. And he will be asked about his money. How did he earn it? And what did he spend it for? Are we ready for those questions? Are we ready to move on to the next life? Have we done our duty towards our children, our next generation, our community, our families? Life is tough. We should make it easy. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that He will help those of us who want to make life easy, He will make it easier for them. فَأَمَّا مَنْ أَعْطَى وَاتَّقَى وَصَدَّقَ بِالْحُسْنَى فَسَنُيَسِّرُهُ لِلْيُسْرَى وَأَمَّا مَنْ بَخِلَ وَاسْتَغْنَى وَكَذَّبَ بِالْحُسْنَى فَسَنُيَسِّرُهُ لِلْعُسْرَى. As far as the one who believes and gives, volunteers, gives out of his time, his energy, his resources, and he fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will make it easy for him to get to what is easy. فَسَنُيَسِّرُهُ لِلْيُسْرَى. If you feel your life is tough, review what you're not doing. Ask yourself, do you pick a chance to do something good, or do you ignore it and wish it goes away? وَأَمَّا مَنْ بَخِلَ وَاسْتَغْنَى. As far as the one who held on to be stingy and he thinks that he doesn't need anybody, he can do without anyone, فَسَنُيَسِّرُهُ وَكَذَّبَ بِالْحُسْنَى. And he denied the truth. فَسَنُيَسِّرُهُ but لِلْعُسْرَى. We will make it easy for him to go into trouble. In another ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ. He who turns away from my reminders, definitely he would lead a miserable life, very tight. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make our life easy. May Allah make it easy for us to do what is righteous. Allahumma ahdina fi man hadayt, wa'afina fi man afayt, wa'tawallana fi man tawallayt, wa'qina wa'asrif anna sharra ma qadayt. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك، ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك، ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا. ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا، واجعله الوارث منا، واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا، ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا، ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا، ولا إلى النار مصيرنا. اللهم أصلح لنا ديننا الذي هو عصمة أمرنا، وأصلح لنا دنيانا التي فيها معاشنا، وأصلح لنا آخرتنا التي إليها معادنا، واجعل الحياة زيادة لنا من كل خير، واجعل الموت راحة لنا من كل شر. ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقواتنا ما أحييتنا. اللهم أحسن عاقبتنا في الأمور كلها، وأجرنا من خزي الدنيا ومن عذاب الآخرة. اللهم اختم لنا مع النبيين والصديقين والشهداء والصالحين. اللهم انصر عبادك المجاهدين في كل مكان. اللهم انصر عبادك المجاهدين في كل مكان. اللهم اختم لنا بالسعادة أجمعين. اللهم اختم لنا بالسعادة أجمعين، وارحم أمواتنا وأموات المسلمين. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم، فستذكرون ما أقول لكم، وأفوض أمري إلى الله. إن الله بصير بالعباد وأقم الصلاة.